Welcome everyone to our graduating Way More Scholars event. And we're so glad you can be here to help celebrate with us. I think most of us who are beaming into this, this Zoom gathering, come here with conflicted emotions. We're excited to honor and celebrate 17 extraordinary graduating scholars who've enriched our community over the last few years and who we want to give a great send-off. But we're also living through a week of outrage and protest over decades of police violence against African-American men and women. And COVID-19 is preventing us from doing what we do every year, which is to hold this event in person, arm in arm. The New Yorker's Susan Glasser aptly noted that 2020 started out like 1974 with a constitutional impeachment crisis, then switched to the horrible combination of 1918 Spanish flu pandemic and 1929's Great Depression, and now 1968 with the socio-political viruses of racism, violence, and economic oppression. Even if the historical analogies that Glasser is drawing are not spot on, I think we'd all agree that we faced one epic challenge after another in just a few short months. Yet to paraphrase Barack Obama, watching the heightened activism of young people in recent weeks of every race and station should make us hopeful. And this is particularly true of the students in our scholars program. Like Parkland activists, you loudly call BS and focus on trying to build inclusive democracy and beloved communities. And a few weeks ago, I asked all of our graduating scholars to reflect on three big questions. The first is, what is the most important thing you learned, gained, or achieved during your UO experience? The second question is, what do you hope you will be doing professionally and or personally in 10 years? And the third question is, what change in our society or world would you most like to see a decade from now? I'm saving your responses, and you actually get them, I'm gonna send them to you in 2030, so stay tuned. But let me share just four snippets. One graduating scholar writes, the phrase equal justice under law is engraved on the US Supreme Court building. But if, but if you are Black, Muslim, Indigenous, or part of any other marginalized community, equal justice under law rarely applies to you. I hope by 2030, equal justice under law becomes more of a reality for marginalized communities. I hope to see citizens standing firm for justice, even if it be argued against their own narrow interests. Another of you notes, I would hope to see a radical reorientation in our political priorities towards care and community over profit and efficiency. This means an emphasis on transformative justice and healing. I would hope to see greater institutional support for grassroots change makers, including youth and those in structurally marginalized frontline communities. A third scholar writes, the most rewarding experiences I had at the UO involve organizing to uplift underrepresented communities. The most important thing I learned from entering higher education is that I have privilege now, now that I have a college degree, and it is my duty as a first generation Latina to give back to my community. And just one more, I'd like people who hold power to have respect for those who do not. I want education, conversation, and conflict resolution to remedy the extreme level of polarization that we are experiencing. I want people to feel safe and empowered to live their lives authentically. I want people and society to be able to hold contradicting truths peacefully. Most of all, I want to lead by example. Well, all of our graduating scholars and all of our other scholars who are beaming into this regularly lead by example and inspire us. And I think today, as you listen to our graduating scholars make presentations, you'll get a glimpse of why they should make us all hopeful. So let me now hand the baton to our assistant director, Thea Croman, to introduce our keynote speaker for today, Eric Ward.
Hi, everyone. Our keynote speaker today is one of the most impressive and engaging experts, educators, and civil rights leaders working in Oregon. A national expert on the relationship between hate violence and preserving democratic institutions, governance, and inclusive societies, he now serves as executive director of the Western State Center. Originally from Los Angeles, Eric Ward began his civil rights work in opposition to the rise of the violent white nationalist movement here in the Pacific Northwest. And as one of a handful of prominent leaders of color working to counter these new manifestations of organized hate, Eric successfully encouraged some violent neo-Nazi leaders to renounce racism and violence. He's continued to work as an educator and organizer, bringing attention to the critical conversation about democracy, white supremacy, and civil rights for nearly 30 years. I really cannot imagine anyone I'd rather hear from at this moment, and I'm thrilled to welcome to our Zoom celebration, Eric Ward. So Eric, I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you, Thea. Good afternoon, everyone. I've been scrolling back and forth across all the faces of this class of 2020, and I am deeply moved. I recognize so many faces. I have spoken to many of you twice in evening speeches, and so imagine my surprise to be invited back yet a third time. To hear me, and I'll try not to put you to sleep this time. I've been told I only have 12 minutes. I am just really honored to speak to you all today and to recognize what each of you has achieved. I too, as an alumni of the University of Oregon, spent probably far too many moments in the classroom sleeping rather than studying. It means a lot that I get a chance to share this moment with you. It is a serious moment. People have asked me, how am I feeling right now? How are we feeling as a nation? And I have shared that it has been a long 4 years, and the last week feels like a longer 4 years. When I speak to my dad, though, he often shares that it's been a long 92 years. The arc of history is so critical. And here you all sit and stand and join together to celebrate the beginning of your part of the arc. You are moving forward today to begin your story. Your story of America. You have worked so hard and accomplished so much that it's important that your stories don't get lost in this moment. The stories of where you come from, the stories of your hopes and your future. But it's also a time of responsibility, a time of carrying more weight for our communities and for each other. Because it's not simply about the stories we tell, but the stories that we want told about us 5 years from now, 10 years from now, a generation from now. I hope as you move forward today that each of you thinks about what story do you want told about you in this moment and the moments that come. You have understood the importance of democracy and democratic practice, that the voice of the people are critical to the structuring of any prosperous and successful society. And while many of us have had privileges earned and unearned, the truth is that far too many in our society never have those opportunities. They are never allowed the voice and the agency to answer the question, who is America and what will America look like? Your task as you move forward in telling your story is creating a story that is broad enough to include others, regardless of their race, religion, gender, sexual orientation, disability, or ethnicity. The job before you is to shape a society that embraces its aspirations, the idea of people living equally under the law, the idea that our institutions are here to lift us up, not to hold us down. You are the leaders of that story. And whether we are talking about a 16-year-old trans Latina living in Portland, Oregon, facing job discrimination, or a 72-year-old white veteran living in Ontario facing the same job discrimination, what we have to understand is that each of us has the right to live, love, and work free from fear and bigotry. This should be our measure as we begin the journey in framing our stories. We are in a very critical moment, a moment that I believe is testing the very foundations of democratic practice. For decades, many before us have struggled and laid down their lives to get us to a place where we can embrace democratic practice as something real. But a backlash has been occurring, and that backlash has punished the idea that all people are created equal. That backlash has sought to undermine the narrative that we are all human beings worthy of respect and attention and opportunity. This backlash has sought to turn us against one another. African Americans against immigrants, immigrants against Muslims, working class white people against single black moms. And as it has turned us against one another and alienated us, our society continues to weaken. I believe that we are seeing one of the largest lootings of America. And I don't mean just by economy, but our dreams of a better society. The idea that a multiracial America is not pie in the sky, but a necessity. This backlash has sought to tire us through political tension and through violence. I want to be honest. You are a generation that will carry an unfair burden. But your burden in this moment is to preserve the paper upon which future generations will also tell their stories. And while the chapter of this story may be difficult for you, your commitment to that task will ensure that the story ends well. This is not how America dies. This is not how humanity ends. This is not the end of our story or your story. Your story is a story of an America that does work. Your story is the idea that all of us have the right to standard living and economy, the right to walk the streets without fear, and the idea that we too can embrace one another as a single community. This means getting down to the brass tacks of democracy. This means turning our attention to make sure our institutions, whether public or private, are more responsive each and every day. Mistakes will be made. Stumbles will happen. There is no rule book around how to make democracy work. But we can't be afraid of making those mistakes. And when we make those mistakes, we have to see them as lessons. Next, we have to make sure the voices of the most vulnerable and impacted are continually lifted up. We need to hear those voices, because therein lies the solutions to the problems that impact us all. Whether we are talking about Black Lives Matters, or Not One More, or 1 Million Rising, or whatever hashtag that resonates with us, what each of us means is room to grow and breathe. That is what it means to lead in a society. That is what you all have worked so hard for over these last years. I'm proud of each of you. I'm proud of the commitment that you have made to your studies. I am proud of what you will accomplish in the years coming. But I'm most proud that each of you knows that democracy is a practice. And the way we practice democracy is not by talking about it, but by doing it. Many of you have committed to that type of volunteerism or career. I want you to continue on that path. I want you to continue to build a society where each of us can tell our stories, the stories of who we are, not just individually, but as a nation. This is not a time of scarcity, but abundance. We have to push back against the growing dark clouds of fear that tell us we cannot trust one another. We have to trust one another. We are all we have, and we are enough. So I congratulate each of you today. I'm honored to be with you, and I'm proud of the stories that you will tell and will be told about you for decades to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric, for your powerful message. At this point, we have a number of great friends of the Wayne Morse Center and of the Scholars Program who wanted to send along their own online messages to you.
Hi, Wayne Morse Scholars, and congratulations to our graduating seniors. I'm Governor Barbara Roberts, Oregon's first woman governor, and a great fan of the Wayne Morse Center and its Scholars Program. The graduating class of 2020 have reached this academic landmark without the usual large ceremonies and celebrations. But few 2020 graduates are better prepared to face this change and this disappointment than the Wayne Morse graduates. Your studies have prepared you for change, for new roads, for advanced thinking, and for leadership. Never has a generation of graduates had a broader opportunity to serve, to reimagine the future, to save our planet, to bring equity and ethics and honor to the role of leadership. As I said in my inaugural address in 1991, each generation has but one chance to be judged by future generations, and this is your time. Make a difference, make your time count.
Well, congratulations on your achievement graduating as Wayne Morse Scholars from the University of Oregon. You've already demonstrated that you have the skills to be the next generation of leaders in this country, and we sure as hell need new leadership these days. Behind me is a very small Heroes Corner in my office. Obviously, Senator Wayne Morse, a great hero to me. Whenever someone says to me, "You remind me of Wayne Morse," that's the greatest compliment they can pay. My good friend John Lewis, incredible leader in the civil rights movement, and then of course, Bobby Kennedy in Baker City, Oregon, just a few weeks before they killed him. What a different world it could have been. But we're confronted with this world today, with the pandemic, upending all our lives, including yours, graduating, you know, remotely, not getting the recognition and being together with all of your fellow graduates. So I just wanted to wish you well and tell you that we will come out of this despite the Trump administration. I'm in Washington, we're passing the fifth bill in the House, which is being resisted by the Senate and the White House, of needed assistance across a wide swath of the economy. But we will come out of this. We will come out of this together. We will come out of this stronger. And you will provide some of the leadership we need to move on beyond pandemic into a brighter future. Thanks very much for all your hard work. Congratulations.
Greetings, Wayne Morse Scholars. My name is Marceline Burke, and I'm the Dean and Dave Frohmeyer Chair in Leadership and Law at the University of Oregon School of Law. More importantly for today's festivities, I am also a co-chair of the advisory board for the Wayne Morse Center for Law and Politics. Even though we couldn't gather together today, I wanted to take a moment to recognize your tremendous achievements. To paraphrase Martin Luther King Jr., the ultimate measure of an individual is not where they stand in times of comfort and convenience, but rather where they stand in times of challenge and controversy. I am confident that you are ready to stand up during these times and to greet the challenges and opportunities that are before you. You are remarkable. And I want you to remember that when you do stand up, you will never stand alone, for you are and will always be an important part of the Wayne Morse Center family. So today, I offer to you a standing ovation. We are so very proud of you. Congratulations, Wayne Morse Scholars.
Congratulations to all the Wayne Morse Scholars in the University of Oregon class of 2020. John F. Kennedy once said that leadership and learning are indispensable to each other. As student scholars and campus leaders, you've already shown how true those words are. Now, as you set out into the world, we are counting on you to use the skills you've gained at the university to help in these times of unprecedented uncertainty. This is the moment for fresh voices to help come up with creative solutions to the many problems we face, and to seize opportunities to improve our communities and the world's health, housing, education, economy, and environmental sustainability. Never stop fighting to build a better world. That is a formula for a meaningful and fascinating life. I'm looking forward to watching you accomplish great things. Congratulations, and take care.
Hello, I'm Ellen Rosenblum, and I'm Oregon's Attorney General, and I'm here to sing your praises on this very special day. One of my favorite photographs was taken in the 1970s in Eugene. It shows Wayne Morse seated on a park bench. You might have seen it. Next to him is a much younger guy, Ron Wyden. Then Senator Morse obviously inspired now Senator Ron Wyden and many, many others. Thanks to that inspiration, you've now learned about the challenge of tackling the big questions of democracy and governance. You've explored forms of political engagement. You've connected with prominent scholars and elected officials. You've been part of a community of students committed to service and justice. Today, we need great leaders like you more than ever. You have the tools, the drive, and the leadership skills to make an important difference. That's why it's such an honor for me to be able to say this one word to you today. Congratulations!
Saludos, Wayne Morse Scholars. It's your friend Reina Lopez from Pecun. Congratulations on your big day, and si se pudo.
Congratulations, Wayne Morse Scholars. I'm Congresswoman Suzanne Bonamici, Double Duck. When I think about Wayne Morse, I think about integrity and about how he fought for civil rights and healthcare and peace. And importantly, how he recognized that an enlightened citizenry is democracy's greatest strength. Wayne Morse showed what it means to be a public servant and how it benefits our communities and our society. I'm grateful that so many of you are following on his path. Go forth with integrity. Congratulations again to all of you.
Hello, Wayne Morse Scholars. Congratulations on graduating from the University of Oregon. We are all so proud of you for all that you've accomplished during your times as students, and we look forward to what you will next do as leaders. We are living through a challenging time right now, challenging and uncertain. But for many of you, it is also a defining time. Your ability as leaders and change makers is needed now more than ever. Our world has been changed by COVID-19. It is times like this when we are faced with extreme challenges that many of you will be called up to help others navigate these challenges. Although none of us have ever experienced anything like what we are experiencing today, what you've gained while at the university and the people you've built connections with make you uniquely qualified to help our world emerge from this crisis more empathetic, more understanding, and more sustainable. I am honored to welcome all of you to our family of alumni, and I look forward to watching all of you accomplish great things in the future. And as always, go Ducks.
Thanks to all our friends for sending those in. We really appreciate everybody, all those leaders, for those inspiring messages. Today is about our graduates, and I'd like now to turn to them. So we'll hear from each of them, each of our graduates. Each scholar is required to complete a practicum experience during their tenure as a Wayne Morse Scholar. The practicum can be a public affairs focused internship or job. It can be applied research, a creative project, even a travel experience. So there's a broad range of experiences that these scholars engage with. And now we'll hear a little bit about the incredible work that each of them have been pursuing while in our program. So first, I'd like to call up Sean Vermilia. Sean, are you there?
I am. So for my practicum experience, I wrote a honors thesis comparing bicycle infrastructure in Copenhagen, Denmark, and Portland, Oregon. I primarily looked at Copenhagen as both kind of a model for Portland's infrastructure and a lesson in some of the things to avoid when constructing a very, very robust bicycle infrastructure network. Ultimately, it really changed my perception about how bicycle infrastructure works, how it's related to other issues like societal values, municipal government control, and more importantly, in my opinion, equity, and many of the affiliated issues there. And I guess I would just implore all of you that if you make regular trips by car that are under 5 miles, consider switching to a bike. It's good for you, it's good for everyone in this country, it's good for the environment, and it will make you and everyone around you a much happier person in a much more livable environment. So, but thank you all for being here.
Thanks, Sean. Thanks for the moral. I'm glad to take something away. Malia, are you there and ready?
Yes. Hi, everyone. My name is Malia Taylor, and I'm a senior from San Diego, California, graduating with a political science major with a concentration in political policy and public action and a legal studies minor. For my practicum, I wrote an honors thesis called Roe v. Wade, The Unexpected Obstacle to Reproductive Rights, an analysis into the cultural relevance and legal insignificance of Roe v. Wade. My thesis examined the failings of Roe v. Wade as legal doctrine and the perpetuation of the myth that Roe v. Wade is the most important case for reproductive rights and women's rights more generally. As I look ahead to law school, the thesis helped me understand the importance of constitutional law, and I hope to work to bridge the gap between legal realities and the public. I've really enjoyed being a part of the Wayne Morse Center to be able to engage in great discussions with other scholars, and I'm especially grateful for the guidance, support, and expertise of both Thea and Dan, who are great professors and leaders on campus. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Malia. Yomaira, are you there?
Yes, I'm ready. Hi, everyone. So I'm going to say something a little different just because the practicum report has been kind of the last thing on my mind. If I'm being honest, I've been attending the protests the past few days, the past 3 days, and yesterday I was actually tear gassed for protesting peacefully. So yeah, the graduation has just really been the last thing on my mind, but that's okay. I'm happy to have my diploma and be able to contribute my efforts to end racial injustice. But I do want to say to Wayne Moore scholars, just to think critically as you enter, you know, post-grad, you know, positions of public leadership, how you can use your skills, your voice, to uplift, amplify underrepresented communities and contribute to the efforts of, you know, of ending systematic issues that are killing Black and brown lives. And that goes beyond police brutality, you know, that exists in our own health, educational, and educational institutions. Turn that anger you feel for injustices into action. But I do want to plug in the 2020 census. That's that was my practicum experience. I got to intern with the US Census in New York City this past summer. And something I learned is how important the census is. That is how we receive money, power, and representation in our community. So please fill it out. And lastly, I learned that I do not want to work in a cubicle for the rest of my life. I want to be out in the community. So thank you.
Thanks. Thanks for your work. Pollyanna, are you available?
I am. Hi, my name is Pollyanna Staley. I'm a philosophy major with a minor in political science, and I plan to pursue a PhD in developmental psychology after working for a year, and hopefully social research, depending on when they hire me. I did an honors thesis entitled PBIS, Towards a Kinder Form of Discipline, in which I connect the philosophies of Friedrich Nietzsche, Michel Foucault, and John Dewey to a kind of philosophical shift in the way that we manage people, emphasizing human-centered values, respect, a culture of care and love, affirmation of positive behaviors, removal of negative stimuli that trigger unwanted behaviors. And finally, the avoidance of punishment entirely. And I hope that this serves as a theoretical framework from which we can structure our society at large. Punishment does not work. Respect, care, love, and compassion are our only ways out. And for further research, I would like to connect Paulo Freire's Pedagogy of the Oppressed and bell hooks' Teaching to Transgress and hopefully turn this into a book in graduate school. And I just wanted to say thank you to Dan and Thea and the Wayne Moore Scholars Program at large. You guys inspire me so much and I appreciate you.
Thank you so much, Pollyanna. Ram, can you join us?
Yes. So my name is Ram Sharma. I'm a political science major and an Arabic studies minor. For my practicum, I interned at the Open Markets Institute last year in Washington, D.C. It's an institute dedicated towards antitrust law and combating America's monopolization crisis. And there, I read numerous court cases and had to condense them to 800-word articles for our newsletter. I also assisted my work colleagues in antitrust legal research. I joined the Open Markets Institute so that I could get my feet wet in the field. I was the youngest member there, so I was able to soak in knowledge from professional lawyers and law students. I was also able to sit in on a House Judiciary Subcommittee hearing, and they were investigating big tech companies like Amazon, Apple, and Facebook. So that was a really great experience for me. Overall, this practicum allowed me to decide that law school and being a lawyer was the correct path for me. And to, you know, finish this little speech, I just want to thank Dan and Thea also for, you know, the mentorship that I've gotten from them the past 3 years. And to the rest of the scholars, y'all have made me like a better person, smarter, and I've learned a lot from everyone else. So yeah, thank you so much for this program.
Thank you so much, Ram. You can all hear my dog also thanking you. Sarah, can you be the next one up?
Hi, everybody. My name is Sarah Pishnary. I'm going to introduce yourself.
My name is Maya.
I am graduating this year after a decade-long quest for my undergraduate degree. My major is in political science with a focus in labor studies. For my practicum, I 6 weeks in the Caribbean region of Colombia studying the peace building process down there. 4 weeks of that program was spent in an urban center, learning at it from an academic perspective, and 2 weeks of that program was spent in Caño Beruguita, a very small village in the Montes de Maria region. Caño Beruguita experienced a complete devastation of their community during the early 2000s. Colombia is home to a 50-year civil war between the longest standing leftist militia to exist within a state in modern history, and the state, the paramilitaries, and international actors. My takeaway from that program was that the state can always wait us out. I used to believe in a diversity of tactics and included people arming themselves as a tactic that people can choose to do. After this experience, I realized we can't afford violence on our side. We will always get beaten if we resort to those tactics. So we need to be smarter, we need to organize, we need to strategize, we need to outsmart our barriers and obstacles. I want to thank everybody involved in this program. You all have taught me a lot, and I have mad, mad respect for each and every one of you, particularly our directors and staff of the Wayne Morse Center. So thank you all for giving us this experience. It's meant a lot.
Thanks so much, Sarah and Maya. And Maya is our youngest member of the Wayne Morse Scholars Program. And it has been so wonderful having her here that I'm thinking of starting an elementary level program. Just kidding, just for Maya. Carlos, are you there for the next one?
Yes, I'm here. So for my practicum, I chose to write an honors thesis for political science. It's a little bit similar to Sarah's in the way that I went about it, but I didn't actually go there, so that kind of sucks. It's called Power and Authority, an examination of strategic governance and its effect on the longevity of Mexican drug trafficking organizations. And I mostly looked at the organizational structures and governing strategies of two organizations, Los Zetas and the Sinaloa Cartel, along with the theories of response and state governance. My main findings were that indiscriminate violence and brutality in the case of the Zetas and a focus on social development and outreach in the case of Sinaloa led to very different outcomes and longevity. In the first case, the organization focuses too heavily on power, which I define in this context as the capacity for control, while Sinaloa balances that power with authority. I define that as the ability to influence. The balance of power and authority, control and legitimacy, brutality and legitimacy, whatever you like to call it, is what makes for effective governance. And effective governance is the key to longevity of drug trafficking organizations, as well as the key to the longevity of the state. This is important because much of the time we consider drug trafficking organizations as just illegal businesses, but they also have requirements for governance that legitimate businesses do not. And I think this is pretty valuable going forward. So yeah, that's all I have.
Thank you, Carlos. Elena, are you there?
Yeah, hi everyone. Thank you for being here today. My name is Elena. I majored in poli-sci and Spanish. And for my practicum, I wrote an honors thesis entitled Ousting Gaddafi, Weighing the Outcomes of Operation Unified Protector. And in this thesis, I examined the 2011 international intervention in Libya and ultimately whether or not it was justified and or successful. I found that the intervention was justified on humanitarian grounds, and I found that while there were some major security issues with the intervention, it was ultimately a qualified success in reaching its goal of protecting human life and human rights in Libya. And this was a valuable experience for me as I seek to go into the field of security studies, particularly from a human rights perspective. So learning about how to research and analyze human rights struggles and how the international community may be of assistance in a way that is non-imperialist and provides for long-lasting stability. So thank you so much to the Wayne Morse Center, Thea and Dan. This has been a really great experience, and I just appreciate so much everything you've all done for me.
Thank you, Elena. We're going to miss you. Alyssa, are you there? I think I saw you.
Hi, yeah, I'm here. So I'm Alyssa. I'm a math and computer science and political science major, and I did my practicum experience at Oregon Health and Science University, where I wrote a software program that standardized the data warehouse the clinical trials department used. Essentially, when we digitized electronic health records back in 2008, 2009, there was a lot of inconsistencies with the way we kept our data and stored our data, and it made it very difficult for medical organizations to do any sort of studies with other institutions. So I helped Oregon OHSU to clean up their data warehouse so that they can join data sets with other institutions and improve their clinical studies.
Awesome. Thank you, Alyssa. Henry Hackinson, are you there? Henry, I saw you. All right.
Okay, can you all hear me now?
There you are, yeah.
All right, excellent.
Wait,
wow.
But we can't see you, Henry. We can hear you, but not see you.
You can't see me, oh dear. Okay, how about now?
Yes, we can see you and hear you.
All right, we figured it out. very well. Well, for my practicum experience, I worked with an economics professor who made his career doing mostly expert witness testimony in lawsuits. And I got to help him out with one case that was about the opioid epidemic. But besides that, I did a lot of other kinds of work, mostly helping him advocate on certain things, mostly very local. So we advocated about we advocated against the pipeline idea stretching across southern Oregon, for instance, into Coos Bay, and worked with some ecologists about that, and to try to understand the impacts so that we could put those impacts in economic terms rather than strictly ecological ones. And that's a lot of what I did. And there's a fair amount of reading funny little rules and laws and things like that as well. But overall, I would say that this experience with this group prepared me for not only work with Ed, but also whatever the hell I'm up to next, in a similar way that working with Ed did too. And so I see them as very much complements to each other. So thanks for all the work that you've put into it, everybody.
Thank you so much, honey. Mm-hmm. Janice, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. So, hey everyone, I'm Janice. I am majoring in ethnic studies and minoring in political science and planning public policy and management. So for my practicum, I did an internship with Huerto de la Familia. So this is a local nonprofit located in Eugene that serves the Latinx and immigrant community. And practically they have two different components where they have the organic garden program and they have the Cambios business program. And the garden program is just providing plots of land to Latinx families so they can grow organic foods. And the Cambios business program is just giving business advice and helping Latinx families to start their own businesses. So I started my internship earlier this year in January. And I've got to do a lot of like things in like office duties, events, and just help out in the garden. So for example, I got to call members in Spanish. So that was really awesome. I got to provide childcare at events and just talk to families and answer questions. And for garden duties, I got to help out at the church in Churchill Garden, but they have other gardens all over town. I got to prepare garden beds, which included putting like cardboard, coffee grinds, and I got to weed and mulch as well in the garden. So essentially what I learned is that it does take a lot to run a nonprofit, and that this work is definitely needed. Another thing I realized was I do want to continue working with Latinx families and immigrant families in the local community, that I do want to go into the nonprofit sector, and I think I want to get my master's in nonprofit management, and that I want to make sure that I empower communities by providing them resources, the tools and education to do the work themselves, and also just uplift their voices. So thanks so much. I really loved being in this program and I'll miss everyone. And I hope, I'm just excited to see what everyone does in the future.
Yeah, thank you. We'll miss you too, Jana. But we'll stay in touch. Eloise, are you there?
I am, yeah. Hi, I'm Eloise. I am a political science and international studies student. And for my practicum, I did it on my honors thesis about pedagogy and the culture of immigration in Eugene Spanish bilingual elementary schools. For lack of a better term, I was inspired by the treatment of immigrants and immigrant children at the border and detention centers. And so I wanted to focus on immigrant children in Eugene. And so I interviewed three teachers from two of the Spanish bilingual schools in Eugene and studied how they cultivated empathy and understanding and empowered their Latinx students in their classrooms and just throughout their school structure generally. So it was a really amazing opportunity. I got to meet some really amazing teachers, and yeah, I want to continue doing research and academia and immigration, or become an immigration lawyer. So that's kind of where I want to head in, the direction I want to head in. And so, yeah, thank you so much to Dan and Tia and everyone. And the Wayne Morse program, it's been really amazing to be a part of it and learn from everyone. So thank you.
Thank you, Eloise. Kelly, you are up next.
Yes, hi everyone. My name is Kelly Franks. I study advertising with a focus in art direction and design. And for my practicum experience, I studied abroad through the School of Journalism and Communication Media in Ghana program. And I worked at a nonprofit and non-governmental organization called Ghana Center for Democratic Development, where I lived in Accra, Ghana for a summer. And Ghana CDD is an independent non-governmental nonprofit research and advocacy institute, and they kind of serve as a think tank and serve as a watchdog for corruption both in Ghana and near West Africa. This was my first introduction to global politics, and on the surface I definitely got to understand how politics outside of our own country works, but I also got to learn more about media and what role social media in particular can play, and how the media landscape is different, specifically within the political sphere across the world. And so it definitely taught me that I don't want to be in a cubicle environment either. And it also taught me how much weight media and like the internet landscape has, and how you can communicate and how you need to be very conscious in how you're delivering your messaging, especially depending on what type of organization you're working for. And so it's definitely inspired me to understand that advertising and greater communication can go down so many different routes, and that you have to be careful which route you go down with and how you're going to choose to give a voice to what issues and what platforms. And so it's definitely inspired me to
reflect on what kind of communication I want to go down. And I think it would be really interesting to work on a political campaign later on and put my skills there. And just getting out of your bubble and not staying in what is safe and comfortable and what you're used to. And I would just like to thank Dan and Thea and Rebecca for this program and your investment in all of us. This program has challenged me and it's made me a better, not only global citizen, but national citizen. I'm from the East Coast, and to learn more about what's going on and where I was living for the 4 years of college definitely made me a better person and student, and I'm very appreciative. So thank you, everyone.
We so appreciate you too, Kelly. Rebecca.
Yeah, I'm Rebecca Foley, and I'm a Family and Human Services major. So my practicum was also a thesis, and it was called Complex Trauma in Foster Youth. So a little context: when I was doing like my original research, I found that the voices of foster parents and the voices of foster youth were not well represented in like formalized research about the foster care system. So because of that, I did kind of a two-part thesis. I did a literature review, and then I also did a survey of foster parents, mostly from around Eugene, about their experiences working with youth with trauma. There's so much to say, but my big takeaway is the foster care system right now is not prioritizing trauma healing, even though most foster youth have experienced really significant trauma, and that by implementing trauma-informed care, we would be better serving the youth that we are supposed to be serving. So I echo a lot of the things people said. I'm going into a master's of social work, so doing this research project I think was a really helpful kind of step in doing independent research, and kind of doing it during a pandemic reminded me how important it is to do work that you really care about, because I don't think I could have kept doing it if I didn't really believe it could make some change. And yeah, I've been really grateful for this program and the leadership, and especially being in a community of scholars who all are really deeply invested in the communities they're serving and things they care about. So thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. Joseph.
Hi, everyone. My name is Joseph, and I'm a graduating senior majoring in political science. And for my practicum, I interned with Rachel Prusak. She is the representative from Oregon's 37th House District, my home district. And I interned with her office during the short session. And some main takeaways, it was really nice to learn about the legislative process, doing constituent outreach, doing all of the office duties, and working with one of the best staffs in Salem. It was honestly a joy each time I drove up to Salem to do that work and working with such amazing people. But sadly though, I think my biggest takeaway at the end is some of the deep-rooted dysfunction in Salem that we saw during the short session, and thinking about how we're going to have to correct those behaviors in the future to make sure our legislative process works, especially for important bills like SB 1530 and other groundbreaking legislation that should be able to pass in the future if we're able to figure out some of these problems. Mirroring everyone else's thoughts, thank you to Dan and Thea. It's been a joy every time.
Thanks so much, Joe. Momo, I think I saw you, that you were able to come after all. Are you there?
Yeah, hi everyone. My name's Momo. I'm a political science major, an ethnic studies, international studies minor. And I'm really tired right now, given the moment. I've been helping run jail support and the bail fund for local protests in Eugene. It's been pretty wild. So weird space right now. But I did my practicum. It was a thesis for the political science department on food sovereignty in Puerto Rico. So I did participatory ethnographic field work this past summer, which looks at how through community gardens and queer agroecology, community members are really resisting kind of the structure of colonialism and cultivating deeply democratic spaces. And it was a really important project for me, just in terms of thinking how we can respond to crisis and build resilient systems, and also just seek political change outside of electoral politics or formal avenues, since there are so many ways that our political power can manifest outside of that sphere. So it was a really amazing project, and I was really lucky to have Dan as my primary thesis advisor. So big shout out to that. And yeah, I also just wanted to say that there is a peaceful march today at 5 p.m. at the courthouse. So if you're in Eugene, show up. This is the time to do that. And yeah, feel free to reach out if you have any questions on the bail fund or want to donate, because we need it. Thanks, y'all.
Thanks, Momo. Thanks for your work. Justice, you are up.
All right. Can you hear me? Hello.
Hi.
Hi. I'm Justice, political science and music major with business administration minor. For my practicum last summer, I participated in a research internship at the Cato Institute, which is the leading libertarian think tank based in Washington, D.C. I worked mainly on education and immigration policy issues and had the opportunity to learn from a lot of brilliant public policy scholars and activists in the D.C. area. Feel like I gained a lot from that and gave me a lot of direction for where I want to go in my future career. And I also just want to say I'm very grateful to Dan and Thea and everyone in the Wayne Morse program for participating in this. It's been wonderful getting to know you. Please definitely hit me up on social media and let's stay in contact after graduation. I'm very excited to see where we all go.
Thank you so much. I think that Cynthia is not here, but Cynthia, if you are here and I'm just not seeing you, pop up, okay? Okay, no Cynthia. Our one missing graduate is Cynthia Aguilar Arizmendi. I just want to acknowledge her amazing work and presence in the program, and we will catch her later. Dan, I think I'm going to turn this back to you.
Yes. Okay, so if this were our normal live event, we would cue Olympic music now because we have a medal ceremony. So we tried mightily to try to get as many of you your medals as possible. First of all, thank you to all the Wayne Morse scholars for giving us a flavor of the amazing work you've been doing. You inspire us, and it was really great to see all of your faces. And I look forward to seeing them all in person sometime. So now we have our medals. So these are all 24 karat gold medals. I'm joking, it's actually not gold, but they're still very cool. 8 years ago, and I saw Margaret Hollick out there somewhere. Margaret Hollick and I, 8 years ago, launched this program. I wanna give a big shout out to Margaret for her support and guidance through all of this. As well as, I can't resist also mentioning all of the Wayne Morse Center's dream team. So you all know Thea Croman. Abby Stilley is our communications director, and she has been critical in actually helping to put together this program. Our co-directors, Director Rebecca Flynn and Director Ellen Herman, and our czarina of all things finance, Christine Waite. So thank you to everyone there who's helped us with this. So Margaret and I were trying to think of something during your graduation experience that would be a nice way of acknowledging your amazing work, your enrichment of our community and so forth. And so the front side of this medal has Senator Wayne Morse, of course. And the back side of the medal is one of my favorite quotes from Barbara Jordan, that democracy is not a spectator sport. And so at this point, if you have your medals, so everyone who's a scholar, if you have your medals, you can wave them now. And I would encourage all of you to put them on. We very much want all of you to, if you have the bandwidth and you're around next spring, to come back again so that we can do this all in person. But we have one last thing you can't miss. We have an amazing photo montage that we want everyone to see that features all of our graduating scholars. So congratulations, everyone, and please stay tuned for a little photo show.
Nothing's gonna ever keep you down. You're the best around.
Okay. So just congratulations, everybody. We're sending out our hugs and love to all of you, and we can't wait to see you in person.